Savior of the world was fallen, His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us, saved of every curse upon Him.
Hi everyone, welcome back to Lakelands Online again this Sunday morning. Thank you once again for joining with us. It's always great to have you with us. We're going to begin again with prayer this week, and like last week, we're going to continue to pray for our land, that we might see a great move of God in His church and in Ireland for His glory. And I'll begin to pray, and then again, like last week, a series of guideline slides will be shown, and time will be allowed for each of us to pray in our own homes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we humbly come before You this morning. We come humbly because of who You are. But we also come boldly because of what You've done Through your son Jesus, you have opened the doorway for us to enter into relationship with you, to know you as Father, to be your children. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for that. And today, Lord, today we remind ourselves that you've blessed us. You've blessed us with every single spiritual blessing that it is possible to bless us with. But most of all, you've blessed us with yourself, with your love, your presence, your grace, your power, so many things. So today, Lord, as we come to pray for this land, Father, guide our prayer and help us to pray. Please continue to pray for our land. We are in so much in need of a move of God. Let's spend some time now worshipping in song.
Chain will break, broken hearts declare his grace. can stop the Lord Almighty? Who 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 can stop the Lord
that sealed the
Are you any good at painting? And I don't mean painting as in painting the walls or a fence or the doors or whatever. I mean painting a picture, painting or drawing a portrait of someone or something. Today I've known people who are truly gifted with this, and I've also known one or two who maybe thought they were, but I think actually one of the easiest ways to know if somebody's gifted like this is to look at one of their portraits and see if it actually resembles the person it's supposed to be. That's a pretty good indicator, isn't it? Yeah. You know, one way portraits are used today is in the medium of tattoos. It could be a family member, it could even be a much loved pet. And sometimes it's because they're a fan of that person, be it a singer, actor, sports personality, some other notable figure or whatever. But listen, here are some examples of portraits of famous people that other people have had permanently etched onto their bodies. Here's the first one. What do you think? That's a good one, isn't it? That is a good one. We've absolutely no trouble at all in telling who that was, have we? Elvis Presley. How about this one? That's another good one. It's obviously Marilyn Monroe. And then finally, yes, it's Michael Jackson. Listen, I'm sure you'll agree with me that whoever drew these, they were talented artists. But I did say sometimes that there are those who maybe think they're gifted in this way, but like, listen, bear in mind again that these people have been, or these have been permanently etched onto people's bodies. Here's another portrait tattoo of each of these ones. I'm not even going to say a word here. I'm gonna leave it at that, you know. But I actually think there's a couple of lessons that we can learn from that. First of all, listen, be sure of your own gifting, but definitely be sure of the other person's gifting before you let them near you with a needle and ink. But anyway. As a young apprentice in the Michelin Tire Company, I worked in their factory in Mollusk, a place just outside Belfast, and there was a guy who worked there called Jimmy Barrow. Jimmy was a talented artist. He was a genuinely gifted guy. And as a wee sideline, Jimmy, to earn a few extra quid, he used to draw people again, or even pets maybe, but he would use photographs. So you would bring Jimmy your chosen photograph and you'd leave it with him for a few days. And then he would return with this amazing pencil drawing of whoever or whatever it was. And listen, it would be good. Really good. Jimmy was good. And I remember having a conversation with him about how he did his work. I was kind of fascinated because I'm not talented like that at all. And again, I'm not an artist here, so there's probably many different methods, but this is what Jimmy did. This is what worked for him. To begin with, he would study the picture. He would look at it for a while. He would leave it down. He would come back, and he would do that many times. And he would do that until he got the image into his mind. He would say that he wanted to know the person so that if, for example, he met them on the street, he would immediately recognize them, know who they were. And then once he got the image into his mind, he would begin the portrait by working on an outline. The kind of big picture, the overall shape of the picture, the overall shape of the head or the face, for example. And he would make a sketch of that outline. And then he would begin to fill in the details, add details, making sure that everything was in its right place, of course, and everything was in its correct kind of proportion to everything else. And listen, the end results were brilliant. They were genuinely really good. They were an accurate representation of the subject. But I suppose today, with all this digital technology, mobile phones, selfies, and Photoshop, there's maybe not such a demand for Jimmy's talent. But I want to use Jimmy's technique to paint a picture, or at least to begin to paint a picture today, of another famous person, and that person is Jesus. Now, obviously, I'm not talking about his physical appearance, but a picture of who and what he is, what he has done, doing, what he will do, you know, his character, qualities, and so on. And our source will be where we can find the best information about Jesus, and that's the Bible. And just like Jimmy, we're going to begin today with an outline, a big picture. And over the next couple of weeks, we'll begin to fill in some of the details. And we're going to get these details from seven statements that Jesus made about himself in the book of John. The times when he said, "I am," followed by whatever, seven times, seven different statements. In John 6:35, "I am the bread of life." John 8 and 12, "I am the light of the world." John 10 and 9, "I am the door." John 10 and 11, "I am the good shepherd." John 11, 25, "I am the resurrection and the life." John 14 and 6, "I am the way, the truth and the life." And John 15 and 6, "I am the vine." And each one of those statements reveals something more about Jesus. Each one of those statements reveal something of his character and actually also his mission on earth. And you know, it's a good practice for us all to take time regularly to remind ourselves of exactly who Jesus is. If you look at the book of Psalms, well, you're going to see the raw realities of life, good and bad, and everywhere in between. But if you look at the book of Psalms as a whole, there's a kind of repeating pattern, regardless of whether the writer's in a good place or struggling. And it's this: he's constantly speaking of, thinking of, and meditating on God, on who God is and what God has done. He talks about the characteristics and qualities of God. Why would he do that continually? Sure, he's just repeating what he already knows. Well, just as it was for the writer of the Psalms. So when we think of these things and meditate on these things, we're drawing near to God. When we think of these things, we're getting to know God. When we think on these things, we're actually reinforcing ourselves, our heads and our hearts with the truth of God, and we are painting a right picture of God in our hearts. And you know, today there's so many different images or ideas or thoughts about Jesus floating about, and they range from the truth through half-truths to complete invention and any kind of a mixture of all of that. It's important that we know who Jesus truly is. And it's important because if we don't know who Jesus really is, then we will never know who we truly are in him. Let me say that maybe in a slightly different way. If we don't know the true and full identity of Jesus, then we will never know our own true identity as a child of the Father. It's important because many people have had a false picture of Jesus, and with that comes false expectations. And then in life, Jesus doesn't match up to those expectations, and many people have been wrongly disappointed and have walked away. It's important because when things are going well in life and we're really flying in life, it helps keep us grounded, not running ahead of ourselves. And it's important when things are hard and difficult in life, we are strengthened, we are encouraged to carry on by a right picture of Jesus. So let's begin to paint that picture. Let's begin to paint that portrait of Jesus today. And to do that, we're going to go way back before Jesus ever walked on this earth as a man. We're going to go to the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 3. And in Exodus chapter 3, we find Moses is in conversation with God. God is sending Moses to Egypt to bring the Israelites out of the slavery that they were in. And Moses is reluctant. He is reluctant. And I actually don't blame him. It was a big ask. It was a really big ask. And Moses knew full well what he was going up against. So he questions God a bit. He wants reassurance from God. And you know, listen, any time God gives you or me or us a big ask, God understands us. He's not offended or put off by our questions and our need for reassurance. But anyway, Moses questions a time or two, and eventually he asks, okay, who will I say sent me? In essence, he's really asking, who are you? And then in verse 14 in chapter 3, we read, I am who I am. Tell them I am has sent me to you. That's strange, isn't it? That's a weird answer. It really sounds like a bit of a tongue twister, but it is a strange answer. Imagine you answer the phone in an office or somewhere, and the person asks to speak to someone, and you say, certainly, who will I say is calling? And they say, tell them I am wants to speak with them. My name is I am. But listen, notice that Moses didn't question this, so maybe he had some sort of understanding what this meant. But the name I am, it actually speaks of so many, things. We could spend a day or more going through that on its own. But for now, I am is a description of God. And it declares, for example, that God is self-existent, self-sufficient, that God is the creator and the sustainer of all things. Not only did God create everything, but without his continued input, everything would just kind of implode again. It says that God is unchanging, what he was, he is, and will be. That he's eternal, always was, always will be. And it also declares, I will be, meaning that God is present. And for Moses, that was music to his ears. God was saying, I'm going with you, I've got your back. But more generally, it means that God didn't just create and vanish. It means that he is present, constantly, intimately connected with his creation, you and me. So that's all very good, Jeremy. I thought we were going to look at Jesus today. Why are we way back here in Exodus? Well, if we fast forward now to John chapter 8, there is an eighth time in the book of John that this phrase, I am, is connected with Jesus, and it's actually the most important one of all. It's the big picture, or it's the outline, if you like. Remember Jimmy's technique of beginning with the big picture, the outline. This is the big picture when it comes to Jesus. In John chapter 8, Jesus is in discussion with religious leaders. And I say discussion like this because I would think that it's probably a polite way of describing the conversation. But at the end of chapter 8, Jesus makes another statement that's, in English anyway, sounds weird. Nearly every bit as strange as what we just read to do with Moses. Jesus says this. He says, "Before Abraham was, I am." Now that sounds like bad grammar. Doesn't make sense at all. But it mirrors what we have just read in Exodus. And it actually gives us the greatest and most important insight into who Jesus is and into his identity. You see, Jesus is simply not saying that before Abraham was around 2,000 years ago or whatever, that he existed. If Jesus had wanted to say that, he would have said, "Before Abraham was, I was." But by using this present tense, "I am," Jesus is claiming complete transcendence over time, beyond time, outside of time. In the last book of the Bible, Revelation, it's actually the revelation of Jesus Christ, the revealing of Jesus. But in that book, Jesus makes another "I am" statement. In chapter 22:13, we read, and this is Jesus speaking, we read, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." And Alpha and Omega, by the way, they're the first and they're the last letters of the Greek alphabet. Today we could say the A and the Z, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. But this is declaring that Jesus is the beginning of all history, the creator. And not just that, he is also the goal. He's the reason for whom all things are made. And all history is about him. All history is moving toward glorifying him. Listen, in a nutshell, Jesus is declaring himself to be God. And all those things that we mentioned from Exodus in relation to "I am," they're a description of Jesus. And when Jesus says, "Before Abraham was, I am," he is saying, "I am God." Now how's that for a big picture? Jesus is God. And you know, the people who heard it, they weren't confused with the grammar or some sort of strange phrase, you know, like Moses. Back in Exodus, they knew exactly what it meant. They knew exactly what Jesus was saying, and that's why they tried to stone him. But we read that he hid himself and got away. So today, as we begin to paint this picture of Jesus, we've discovered the outline, the big picture, upon which everything else will be placed. And we've discovered the single greatest truth about Jesus, that he is God. So what does that mean for us today? What does that mean for you today and for me today? Well, think about this. It's this Jesus who wants or desires a relationship with each one of us. It's this Jesus who left heaven to come to earth. It's this Jesus who lived a normal, ordinary, but perfect life. It's this Jesus who died on the cross so that you could have a relationship with him. It's this Jesus who calls us to himself. It's this Jesus who is calling you today if you don't yet have a relationship with him. It's this Jesus who wants to be known by you just as you are known by him. It's this Jesus who walks with us each and every day. It's this Jesus who never leaves us or walks away from us. It's this Jesus who sticks closer to us than a brother. It's this Jesus. It's the "I am" who loves you and who loves me. It's this Jesus who calls you into obedience and a close walk with him, worshipping and serving. It's this Jesus who calls everyone, without exception, by the way, it's this Jesus who calls everyone to work with him in letting others know who he is and what he has done so that others can know him too. It's this Jesus. So listen, if you're watching and you're thinking, okay, I would like to know maybe a little bit more about him, then listen to his call. Answer his call. Come to him. If you're not sure about how to do it or go about it, it's actually very simple. Just talk to him. You come to God, you recognize that there are many things in your life that are wrong and that these things put up a barrier between you and God. You recognize that when Jesus died on the cross, he was paying the price, taking the punishment for all that you've done wrong. You ask for forgiveness. You give yourself and your life to him. The barrier's removed. If you'd like to know more, if you'd like to talk about this, please get in touch. Our contact details will appear at the end of this video. And for the Christian, listen, Jesus is calling you into a deeper relationship and revelation of him. He's calling you, as we said, into his mission, his purpose. Draw near to him today. Draw close to him. Hear his heartbeat for his creation. So we're coming to a close. We now have the outline, we have the big picture, and over this next couple of weeks we're going to fill in some of these details and to add details to this Icelandic outline. And each time we add another detail, a more accurate picture of Jesus will begin to emerge. So please listen, I would invite you to join with us over the next few weeks as we do just this. Let's see who Jesus really is. And listen, as we do, another portrait will emerge, and it will be that of our true identity in him. Thanks for joining with us today. God bless you for this incoming week. And let me finish by reading a blessing from Scripture. It's that blessing that we've heard sung now so many times recently. And the words are from Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 to 26. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and grant you his peace. Amen. God bless.